Hi, my name is Jonathan Roth. I'm coming to you from Vancouver, British Columbia, and this is This Week in Geopolitics. I'm joined from Austin, Texas by George Friedman, the chairman of Geopolitical Futures. George, how are you?
I'm well. How are you?
I'm doing very well. Just wanted to touch base about an issue that I think a lot of people are thinking about right now, and that is the U.S. election. So many people are saying, and it seems like it's gathering pace every election, that that this is indeed the most important election of everyone's lifetime. You may have a bit of a different tack on that. Why don't you explain your perspective? Is this the most important election of all of our lifetimes to date?
Well, we have to explain why it's important. It's important because Donald Trump is running, and there are people who think he is the Messiah and people who think he's the devil. And if he's elected or not elected, this makes it the most important. But we go through this every time. To me, the gold standard of important elections was 1861, because it elected Lincoln and led to a civil war that 600,000 people died in. So when we think about really critical elections and real problems when someone's elected, that's up there. Let's think of 1968. The leading candidate for the Democratic Party is assassinated right after winning the California primary. Martin Luther King is also killed. After Robert Kennedy is killed, there are massive riots at the Chicago Convention Center. Thousands are arrested, beaten. It is total bedlam. And the outcome is the election of Richard Nixon, which, of course, has its own story and its own problems. But, 1968, and I was alive for it, and many people were, that was a chaotic convention. That was a chaotic year, and it really mattered because the Vietnam War was raging, and the issue on the table was, how do we solve the problem of Vietnam? So you had huge issues on the table, total chaos. The guy elected winds up being almost impeached, has to resign his office. Everything that could go wrong did go wrong, and the Republic survived. But at the time, being there, everybody said this was the apocalypse. If Nixon won, that'd be terrible. If he didn't win, it would be terrible, and the country's falling apart.
Now let's talk specifically about Donald Trump and the presidency and the executive branch. Does the president really have as much power as we all believe he does?
He was designed to be one of the weakest political leaders in the Western world. He faces the Supreme Court, which in the case of Obama constantly overruled his actions. The legislature is divided into two houses with two totally different rules, both of which have to be navigated, and there are 50 states that are technically sovereign. So the president's ability to get anything done is pretty severely limited. And one of the interesting things is that in most ways, Congress is the most important of the three branches of government. Everybody focuses on the president, but it's really Congress that's going to be making the fundamental decisions on the Supreme Court and other things.
Now, the U.S. president, the one area that he or she does have a lot of influence, and that is foreign policy. And about a year and a half ago, I had a very interesting conversation with, I would say, one of the world's most prominent central bankers, a private conversation. And this individual told me that that they felt that the world was maybe in 1936 or 1937, geopolitically and economically. So when we take a look around the world, what's happening, particularly in Eastern Europe with Russia, with China, you know, vis-a-vis the U.S. and the issues in the South China Sea, does that not beg maybe turning your argument a bit on its side that maybe this is indeed an incredibly important election just from a foreign policy perspective?
It is. The president's decisions matter, but his power is limited by reality. He can decide to invade Iraq. Doesn't mean he's going to win in Iraq. He can decide to get involved in Syria. Doesn't mean he's going to succeed. So the problem he has domestically is that he's continually hedged around by other political forces. The problem he has in foreign policy is that he's not omnipotent. He can't simply decide what's going to happen. And as we know in American history recently, not going back to Vietnam, presidents tend to fail and destroy themselves when they engage in these foreign activities. He has more freedom to undertake them, but the outcome is not in his control.
I've heard you describe the U.S. as essentially being an empire to a certain extent. If that is indeed the case, where is the U.S. in terms of the cycle of empires? And if we are indeed on the backward slide of that, does that not again point to the fact that this is yet indeed the most important election of our lifetimes?
We have barely begun. Up until 1991, the United States was one of two powers. And as I just mentioned, Vietnam, Korea, and other places, it wasn't clear that we were going to be defeating the Soviet Union. We did. In 1991, for the first time, no European power was a global power. The United States was and is the only global power. And for the past 25 years or so, we've been trying to figure out how to do this. Our first view was the world is going to be wonderful and there's going to be no problems. And now it's a long war fighting the Islamic world. Well, this is very much like the British Empire. The British Empire suffered an absolute catastrophe at its very beginning. A group of third world know-nothings beat them. I'm talking about the American Revolution throwing the British out of North America. So when we look at that, when we look at the state of the American Empire, it is pretty much where you would expect it to be 25 years after it emerged as the major power. So we're way at the beginning. We're in the process of defining what we're doing. And part of the chaos of our current political system is when you move from being one of two powers to the only power, after a while, the distortions and the tensions and the disagreements pile up and you begin having domestic tension. And that tension inevitably follows from the fact that a lot of people don't think of us as an empire. A lot of people don't want to be an empire. A lot of people want to turn the clock back to a time when we weren't the dominant force in economics, politics, and military affairs. So there's a lot of nostalgia competing with a lot of ambition. And you get the kind of lecture we're getting now.
Subscribe for free to George Friedman's weekly column, This Week in Geopolitics, by clicking on the link in the description below. Each week you'll receive for free George's in-depth analysis of the events and forces shaping our world. Again, click on the link below to subscribe to George Friedman's free weekly column, This Week in Geopolitics.